cris sourds du pays qu'on enchaîne. Oh, et partisans, ouvriers et paysans, c'est l'alarme.
Welcome back to Lecture 10. The Age of Revolution takes a strong turn because today we'll study the American Revolution and the French Revolution, and we'll study the impact that they had on Britain. We'll start with the American Revolution and the War of Independence, focusing on the years between 1776 and 1783. We'll focus in particular on the increasing frustration of the colonies in North America that we tackled in the previous lecture. Then we will discuss the fact that Britain had no intention to meet the demands of the colonies, reacting in a bit of an LOL way. And we'll see that Britain actually, rather than try and appease the situation, rather than try and make it a little bit better, Britain actually threw a bit of oil on the fire and tried to punish the colony. Leading, of course, to the Declaration of Independence. Then we'll study the French Revolution and the impact that they had on Britain, in particular the wars that the country was involved in versus Britain. So, of course, we'll see that there is a strong connection between the two. We'll study first the way in which the French democratic alternative was seen as both a source of inspiration, but also definitely as a cause for debates, very controversial and heated debates. The British states decided to fight back against the French Revolution, and we'll see that Democrats and political dissenters in Britain were actually repressed. Right, before we begin, let us paint a picture. We have the stability of the post-Glorious Revolution constitutional settlement. Remember the Bill of Rights. Power was then in the hands of a parliament, it's parliamentary monarchy, constitutional settlement, but that parliament was not representative. There was a strong sense of self-satisfaction that's permeated the 18th century, with a myth of Britain as the country of liberty and progress, because it was meant to have the most consultative form of government in Europe, because it was based on a parliamentary system. But remember that this parliamentary system was not representative of the country, that it was not democratic. What we see is that the ideas of the Enlightenment and then events in North America and France that we'll tackle today actually led to this vision being challenged, which then raised the issue of democracy. Let's begin with the American Revolution and the War of Independence. And we'll focus first on the frustration that prevailed in the British colonies in North America. Now, the colonies were forced to trade with Britain only. They didn't get much of a choice. They paid taxes to the British Parliament in London that they sent no elected representatives to. So remember the idea of no taxation without representation? See here that frustration that stems from taxation and no representation. So we see demands for liberty in trading and political representation. So the liberty to trade with whoever they want rather than simply the mother country, and the liberty to represent themselves, to be there, to bring representatives to the table. Now, between the Glorious Revolution of 1688 and the middle of the 18th century, Britain had largely failed to define the colony's relationship to the empire and create a coherent program of imperial reform. Why this failure, perhaps, is the question that you'd have in mind. First, there was the fact that Britain was at war with Spain. There was the War of the Spanish Succession at the start of the century, then the Seven Years' War in 1763. basically constant war was politically consuming, economically expensive, and just you have to focus your attention on the fact that you're constantly at war, more or less. Second, there were competing visions of empire that divided British officials, with on the one hand old Whigs and their Tory supporters, which believed in a very authoritarian form of empire that would be based on conquering territory and extracting resources, versus the radical Whigs that based their own imperial vision on trade and manufacturing. All of that led to a failure of actually defining a clear relationship and a healthy relationship to the colonies. All that information is taken from the American YAWP that you'll find online. So if you just type the letters YAWP, you can find loads of interesting resources that have to do with the revolution and more, basically that have to do with American history. Now, in Britain, there was no intention to meet the American demands. There was Tory dominance in Parliament from 1760 to 1815, and the Tories supported the authority of the monarch more than the Whigs. They supported, in particular, the authoritarian tendencies of King George III, that you can see pictured here, looking like he's having a whale of a time. The first British-born George, who started reigning in 1760, as it happens. George had lots of problems, and many of them were the US colonies. But instead of dealing with those problems, as one does when one wants a healthy relationship, the government made things worse. Basically, what happened is that there was a series of mistakes that was committed by the British government. There was the expensive 7 Years' War that I've mentioned a second ago when I referred to how it ended. Britain made the colonies pay for it with more taxes because, as you know from your own experience of waging war, obviously, I mean, not we all know, or not, Britain made the colonies pay for the war because war is expensive, basically. The Stamp Act, for instance, passed in 1765, basically meant that there was duty to pay on every legal document, so raising basically a tax by using the colonies. America's reply was one that was quite clear: no taxation without representation. We see the influence of Magna Carta there, obviously. The Tea Act in 1773 really kick-started things, because the colonies were then forced to import British tea, which led to a strong reaction. The Boston Tea Party and tea parties around the country.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Don't catch you slipping now. Look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping now. Look how I'm living now. Police be tripping now. Yeah, this is America. Guns in my area. I got the strap. I gotta carry 'em. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go into this. Yeah, yeah, this is gorilla. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go get the bag. Yeah, yeah, or I'ma get the pad. Yeah, yeah, I'm so cold like, yeah. Yeah, I'm so dull like, yeah. We gon' blow like, yeah.
Now, the Tea Act, to be more specific, meant that duty had to be paid when the ship unloaded, once it got to the coast, and that cost a lot of money, that was expensive. In 1773, the Boston Sons of Liberty resolved to actually prevent the landing and the sale of the tea, and therefore the payment of any duty on the tea. And they decided to do that at the risk of their lives and property, whatever the cost. So men appointed to guard the docks and make sure the tea remained on the ships until they returned to London were there in order to make sure that no one actually decided to go against that resolution. And this worked, and the tea did not reach the shore But the ships did not go back to London either. So dozens of men disguised as Mohawks made their way to the docks, to the wharf. And then tea was either dumped or seized, not just in Boston, but this then spread to Charleston, Philadelphia, New York. Numerous other smaller tea parties therefore took place throughout the year 1774. Now, the reason for this frustration and anger needs to be explained a little bit further. Colonists developed their own understanding of how they fit into the empire, with the colonies not necessarily actually wanting to rebel and separate from the mother country, but only wanting to fully benefit from British prosperity and participate in British decision making, because they had to pay taxes and they did not get a say in that. So what they wanted is that say in how things were being decided. Some in Britain, like the Whig Member of Parliament Edmund Burke, that you can see pictured here, defended the colonies and invoked the British political tradition of liberty and consultative limited government that had prevailed and that had been promoted by various thinkers since the Glorious Revolution. The colonies, therefore, he believed, should be given representation. Others, like radical Thomas Paine, that's pictured on the slides, said that the British political system was too corrupt. The only way for America to ever be free, to ever be equal, was to separate from Britain. He published these ideas in a book called Common Sense in 1776. Now, during the 7 Years' War that we've referred to a second ago, Ben Franklin wanted to unite the colonists, to fight the French, and to convince the British government to support a unified government in America, but it didn't work. Nonetheless, that image that you've got here on screen, the join or die picture, later on actually became quite a symbol. Men and women politicized the domestic sphere as well by buying and displaying items that reveal their strong position for or against parliamentary actions. For instance, you can see here a teapot which celebrates the end of taxation on goods like tea, for instance, that we've mentioned a second ago, making clear the owner's perspective on this particular taxation. British punitive measures against the colonies led to the American Congress of Representatives from the 13 colonies signing the American Declaration of Independence on July 4th. And you can see here that historical moment depicted by Trumbull. War between Britain and the 13 colonies led to, of course, as you know, the victory of the colonies in 1783. The war ends and the United States of America were born. Britain kept the West Indies and Canada, but the loss of America would symbolize the fall of the first British Empire. George III would never fully recover from that trauma. Hence the madness of King George, depicted in the film. You can see a screenshot from the film depiction. His son, George, would reign instead of him as Prince Regent. Tough for George III's. Yeah. Left alone. Now, from the American Revolution to the French Revolution, it was felt, or it was almost as if a wind of liberty was sweeping throughout Europe, had inspired Europe with a new ideological climate. For example, with Lafayette helping the Americans and bringing back the ideas of liberty all the way to France. For instance, as well, the defense of American colonies in the name of free trade. So that would be an ideology that went against protectionism. Competition between nations was to be redefined as free trade in a context of peace, and borrowing these ideas from Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, 1776. The way for all nations to prosper was to make money rather than war, so peaceful wealth. There was a belief in the Wealth of Nations that the markets was guided by an invisible hand, with the economic activity of individuals that should not be controlled by the state. The forefather of economic liberalism and the defender of free market capitalism is therefore remembered as Adam Smith. But at the time, it's important to note that this was a liberation from the economic tyranny of the state. Now we're going to talk about guillotine at that point. And perhaps you didn't know that, but the last person to be guillotined in France was 1977. The death penalty in France was abolished in 1981. The death penalty in the UK, by the way, was abolished earlier in 1965. So let's talk about the French Revolution. Let's talk about the wars against Napoleon. Now, of course, you'll remember the key events that I will nonetheless make sure that you actually remember: the storming of the Bastille, La Prise de la Bastille on July 14th, 1789, the abolition of aristocratic privileges that was voted on August 4th, 1789, Declaration of the Rights of Man in August, and the French Republic, 1793. Now, let's focus on the French democratic alternative. It inspired radical Whigs in the UK. It inspired political dissenters in Britain, with reform associations that were created in order to try and change the parliamentary system. There was a strong intellectual debate that basically opposed Edmund Burke in his reflections on the revolution in France and Thomas Paine that we've mentioned before, if you remember, in relation to the colonies. Now, Burke denounced the French Revolution while Paine endorsed the French Revolution in the name of liberty and equality. Burke defended Britain's stable status quo, established since the Glorious Revolution of 1688, and it defended its organic constitution, meaning that there was no constitution per se, there was no such text in an act of itself. However, Paine believed that the Glorious Revolution had not been that glorious in a sense, because it hadn't gone far enough, so we can see two different standpoints on that question. Burke believed that there was no need to extend the right to vote, since Parliament knew what was best for the people and had the people's best interest at heart. And that was different, because according to Paine, every man should be given the right to vote in order to have a free say about his own life. So we see very different notion of what liberty means, with Burke defending the idea that the right to vote was in the end-all and be-all people being, in a way, ruling themselves, because it was believed that Parliament knew better than people themselves. Burke also defended inherited rights and established customs, so that is a form of conservatism versus Paine's idea that Britain needed a new revolution, one that would go far enough. Now, interestingly enough, there was also Mary Wollstonecraft, who extended Paine's equal rights idea to women in Vindication of the Rights of Women, that was published in 1792, basically suggesting something that would come to be known as the equality of the sexes. The British state fought back against the French Revolution that was seen as a threat, especially from the moment when there was a radicalization of the revolution with the execution of the king and the Terreur, La Terreur, with as many as 40,000 executions, and with the guillotine's invention working over time. The British government and the ruling classes feared the French Revolution's impact on British society. It was seen as an attack on privilege, private property and traditional power. And you may remember that private property was closely associated with liberty in Britain. So Britain's attempts to stop the French revolutionary movements became quite obvious, especially, of course, when the country was at war against France from 1793 to 1815. You can see here on this particular depiction, William Pitt, Tory Prime Minister, against the French Republic, that was embodied by Napoleon, Napoleon not embodying the French Republic, but one and then the other in turn. And here, this is Gilray, who was a very famous cartoonist, that illustrates the carving up of the world into two spheres of influence, the British versus the French one. Same year as Trafalgar, of course. Another interesting depiction that you might want to take a look at and maybe perhaps even pause at this point. This depiction was illustrated and accompanied by a patriotic song, as it was called. It was typical of the many songs, images and publications that flooded the print markets, urging loyal British solidarity in light of a possible French invasion, so patriotism. King George III, surrounded by symbols of peace and liberty, was illustrated on this particular document. If we go back to the image, well, across the channel, we see the figure of Napoleon that is stalked by poverty and universal destruction. The lyrics of the ballad that accompanied the image celebrate English freedoms, and they salute the solid body of man who stand ready to destroy, and we're quoting the song, The Gallic Pests. This information is taken from the British Library's website. If you're curious, feel free to look it up. Unity against the French was seen as vital, and this is an opportunity for us to insist on the second act of union in 1800 with Britain, England and Wales and Scotland being united with Ireland, and basically the current Union flag being born, the United Kingdom's flag, Union Jack. The Democrats and political dissenters in Britain were repressed. Sometimes they were forced into exile, for instance, Spain, that we've talked about. There was counter-propaganda with the idea of French liberty being associated with anarchy, or even worse, tyranny. For instance, another Gilray caricature depicts a Frenchman. The Frenchman is the one that's wearing the cocards. He's deluded, starving, cold. He's wearing the disgusting tattered clothes. It's very poor, literally sans culottes. And this is a reference to food shortages and political delusions, according to Gilray, versus the Englishman, it's represented as very cushy, eating beef, drinking ale, and complaining about taxes, and just basically pigging out, eating quite a lot. The UK defeated Napoleon in 1815 and acquired a new international status as number one world power. Western Europe was weakened by the wars, except for two main victors, Russia and the UK, two major rivals in the 19th century. So we see British victories at Trafalgar and, of course, Waterloo, Morne Plaine. At home, Britain's military Victory meant that its political regime was left untouched and given legitimacy. Now, actually, in 1815, the French adopted a parliamentary monarchy. Yet, mass popular involvement in the war efforts might lead to more democratic demands. So that's something that we'll be discussing in the next lecture, the question of basically paving the way to proper democracy, which is a long way ahead. To conclude, the War of American Independence was a massive blow to Britain's power, but in fact, it reoriented British imperialism towards the East with India, one of the jewels of the British Empire, and the Pacific. French Revolution and the wars against France reinforced the undemocratic parliamentary regime of an even more centralized country. Both of the UK. Feel free to check out more information on that question in Mioche. Remember that you need to memorize the lessons. Perhaps what I would invite you to do as well is work on a recap of the key events, of the highlights in terms of who, when, what, where is important. For each of the centuries that we've talked about ever since Henry's reign in particular. That would be a great way of making sure that you know things quite well and that you have an idea and a sense of when things happened and for what reasons. Take care of yourselves and see you very soon.